Hello and welcome to Newsfeed, your daily dose of what people are talking about online, from news stories to what's trending. It was game on this weekend at Turkey's biggest gaming convention, dubbed the country's Comic-Con. And those players are just gonna keep on playing. Gaming is huge here in Turkey. The latest stats show that half of the population of 85 million game in some capacity. So it's no surprise that more than 100,000 of those gamers, along with industry folk, packed Gaming Istanbul here this weekend. With so much hype surrounding the convention, both in the real world and online, our very own Sare went to check out what all the fuss was about.
Game conventions offer a world of limitless excitement and competition, and Gaming Istanbul 2023 is no different. With the thrill of esports showdowns, jaw-dropping cosplays, and exclusive premieres, this weekend-long event is where the future of gaming takes center stage.
Gamers, cosplayers, developers have all gathered here over their love for adventuring in pixelated landscapes. But this event is not just for showcasing games. It's also a bustling hub of imagination and collaboration. And with a turnover like this, it's no surprise that Istanbul is the cool new kid on the block for the gaming industry.
We are one of the 8 biggest gaming events in the world, and we are welcoming almost 4,000 professionals and press at Gaming Istanbul. We have 90 studios here and 3 more actually doing their world launches right here. For visitors, we have a lot of entertainment.
One way for the participants to have fun is being captivated by the vibrant presence of dedicated cosplayers.
I'm cosplaying Alexstrasza from World of Warcraft.
I cosplay Brim, Stone, and she cosplays
Deadlock from Valorant.
A long time.
Yeah, mine.
Even the glove took a week.
Like a month to gather around everything.
I've been cosplaying for 2 years now. It's so fun.
While these doppelgangers are choosing to indulge their inner child by acting as their favorite characters, some are creating entire worlds for them.
This is a childhood dream. When I was playing games on consoles as a kid, I wanted to make games, and I shaped my academic and professional life according to that. Now, I have a game studio and make games with my friends.
I am a historian myself, and I like to write things, I like to create new worlds. So I started writing little pieces, our first debut project called New Cycle. New Cycle is the city builder and colony survival, which took place in a post-apocalyptic universe setting.
And some of those worlds are even offering to pay for your time.
People need to go around the game and look for treasures. And if you find them with the green signal, you just go, switch your equipment, and you can start digging for earning our token and various of cryptocurrencies in our blockchain.
Most of these young developers are just starting out their careers.
We are self-funded and we started coding this project 7 months ago. And we have been developing with the whole team for 2 months. We have a 22 people team and we hope to release our game in a year. We knew our strong elements before coming here, but the feedback we got here was invaluable. Being in the kitchen of this game, we have our own illusion of it. Coming here helps break that and face the reality.
I like it. I like the atmosphere. But obviously, the game needs a lot more work. With more playstyles and a better game AI, this will definitely be better.
The developers are not shying away from criticism. In fact, it's one of the driving motives for them to take part in the event.
We had a 6-month development cycle where we were holed up in an office, so we didn't have many opportunities to test our game. When people come and test our games in events like this, we learn whether what we worked on for so long works or not. We note the criticism and adapt when we get back in the office.
From embracing childhood dreams to pioneering a new era of indie games, Gaming Istanbul is an arena of innovation and a testament to the boundless possibilities of the industry.
One of Japan's most scenic sites, Mount Fuji, is suffering due to a sharp increase in the number of tourists. Hordes of visitors are causing human traffic jams and spreading litter. Furthermore, public toilets are overflowing and filthy. With more tourists comes more traffic, and the buses bringing hikers are also damaging the environment. Now authorities are considering taking drastic measures to protect their sacred mountain.
Due to overtourism, Mount Fuji may start limiting the number of hikers and charging them. Overtourism has been a problem at the sacred mountain for a while, but the trend of bullet hiking, which is climbing Mount Fuji and coming down in the day without resting at the designated huts, has become extra popular after international tourism resumed. This has caused an increase in accidents, garbage and traffic. If you're thinking of climbing Mount Fuji next year while traveling Japan, please do your research in advance because you may find a new and stricter set of rules in place.
Mount Fuji is not the only wonder that's being hurt by too many visitors. The Croatian city of Dubrovnik has become one of Europe's biggest attractions, but hordes of visitors are putting pressure on the historic buildings and ancient cobblestone streets. Authorities want travelers to carry rather than pull their rolling suitcases. It will cut noise levels as well. Now, nothing screams romance more than the idyllic canals of Venice. The floating city attracts 80,000 visitors a day, and they're polluting the waterways and cramming the streets. Officials are trying to mitigate the effects by imposing a tourist tax, entrance fees to sites, and pre-booking. Sunrise over the 9th century Khmer Empire temples in Cambodia's Angkor Wat attracts up to 2 million visitors a year. But there's little spiritual serenity these days. The influx of tourists is damaging the historic site and putting pressure on limited drinking water supplies. So, of course, all those tourists need somewhere to stay. And thanks to World's 50 Best Brands, they can select the very best. It's an institution that's been giving top tips on where to eat and drink for 25 years. And this year, for the first time, it's launching the World's 50 Best Hotels. Just last week, hoteliers, travel journalists, and industry insiders got together in London to applaud not only their own achievements, but also their resilience during the challenging pandemic era. The event unveiled a prestigious list honoring the most exceptional hotels from around the globe. Among these gems on the list, 21 are in Europe. Italian newcomer Passalacqua clinched the very top spot. The 50 Best Hotels Awards host city London proudly claimed 4 hotels on the list, including the venerable Claridge's in 16th place. Asia, too, was well represented with 18 hotels, occupying the second, third, fourth, and fifth positions, painting the continent in vibrant hues of hospitality. Down under, the Kalil in Brisbane waves the Australian flag proudly at number 12. Crossing the Pacific, Rosewood Sao Paulo stood as South America's sole representative in a respectable 27th place. And Amman, New York, a newcomer, reached the 25th spot as the highest U.S. entry. But it wasn't just the rankings that stirred excitement and holiday plans. Special awards were also given out. Gleneagles in Scotland received the prestigious Art of Hospitality Award. The Capella Bangkok earned Best New Hotel as the highest ranked establishment opened in the past 2 years. And in South Africa's Kruger National Park, Singita Lodges emerged as the smallest contender in terms of size at 15th place, while also claiming the Eco Hotel Award, proving greatness comes in all sizes. Unfortunately, all good things must come to an end, from hotels and holidays to the world of work. For the past couple of years, Gen Z has been shaking up the status quo at the workplace. The workforce's youngest generation has been championing greater work-life balance, flexibility, and better pay. Although Gen Z's mission of reshaping work as we know it has gotten some flack from older colleagues, Zoomers' changes to the professional environment go beyond making crop tops acceptable office attire. Thanks to Gen Z, we're also seeing changes in office lingo. A recent survey in the UK found that more than 70% of employees believe office communication has become less formal in the past 5 years since older Gen Z first entered the workforce. That's not really surprising, considering almost all Gen Z responders in the survey said they're not shying away from being themselves while at work. And among those main characters, 40% of them think these changes shouldn't just stop at how you write an email. For them, half the business talk is meaningless and in desperate need of simplification. Zoomers are not the only ones feeling left out, though amid all these workplace changes, nearly half of Gen Z employees and their likeliest work besties, the millennials, feel alienated because of corporate jargon. And it seems like there's almost no escape from it, as nearly 60% of them said their colleagues are overdoing it. To be completely fair, it does turn into gibberish at times in some business meetings. Here are some examples of that draconian corporate speak.
I know we're on back-to-back meetings here, so I'm going to try to be swift and not bring you past the hour to be respectful of your time. So my name is Em, and I am the Senior Account Manager for Managerial Logistics, Coordination, Implementation, Integration, and Digitization. So we're working with Ronnie's digital team to focus on optimizing processes and tools for the organization. And our large-scale project is really going to re-energize, synergize, and digitize all of our systems and processes across the organization to make us work more effectively. We've also just hired a new empowerment focal who is going to take a look at the 30,000 foot view and help us strategize and innovate. We've been benchmarking a lot of companies. They're doing the same things. If you understood what I just said in the last 30 seconds, I'm so sorry to tell you that you are lost in the corporate sauce.
Okay, it may take some time to phase out that kind of dialogue, but at least some things are quick to change. The most obvious is how we sign off emails. Yours truly, sincerely, these words are in their flop era. To whom it may concern is out too, along with signing off by writing respects. Also, has anyone ever said with compliments, ever? All of this reminds me of that recent TikTok trend where corporate accounts were sharing employees' quirky email sign-offs.
How my Gen Z office signs off emails.
Wow, I gotta start signing off my emails just like that. All right, there was a time that if you wanted to know the most popular songs of the week, you tune into a show like this.
Exclusive reviews of the top 10 on Billboard's pop, soul, country, and album charts for the week ending September 5th, 1982. Now, here's Casey Kasem.
Thank you and hello again, everybody. Welcome to America's Top 10. Let's get right to the action.
Wow, that was a blast from the past. Back then, television and radio chart shows were everything. They could make or break a song. But with the advent of streaming, the way in which we consume and purchase music has completely changed. Take this scene from Netflix's Stranger Things that gave one song a new lease on life.
We need this right here, right here. I got it. Go. Now!
It's not just the latest releases that get streamed the most. Unexpected old tunes like Kate Bush's Running Up That Hill, like what you heard there, propelled back to the top of the charts after being featured on Stranger Things. Last year, the classic from 1985 earned Bush millions of dollars and shook the internet into a frenzy, spawning 1,000 memes. In the last couple of years, TikTok has found itself as one of the most important and influential platforms in the music industry. So it makes perfect sense that Billboard, the curator of popular music, has teamed up with TikTok to produce a weekly and official TikTok Billboard Top 50 chart. As the official blurb puts it, it's a weekly ranking of the most popular songs on TikTok in the US based on creations, video views, and user engagement. And here is the very first TikTok Billboard chart top 10. Sexy Red claims the prize for being the first number one and is bound to be a game show question in years to come. Doja Cat is number two, and Taylor Swift's August rounds off the top three.
First official Billboard chart for songs on TikTok. The chart is based on a combination of creations, video views, and user engagement by the U.S. TikTok community. And the first artist to claim the number one spot is Sexy Red with Ski. I mean, who can resist a good ski? Every Thursday, Billboard will bring you the verified list of the hottest songs on TikTok by monitoring music discovery and engagement on the platform in the United States. To find the TikTok Billboard Top 50 each week, users can simply go to any sound detail page and tap the top right button to access the charts page. This week, Doja lands at number 2 with Paint the Town Red. I said what I said, I'd rather be famous instead. Thanks to some quick feet and double horns. And Taylor Swift's folklore track, August, has everyone running on the beach. Landing her at number 3. For a full look at the TikTok Billboard Top 50, check in the app or on billboard.com. Happy liking and posting, and we'll see you on the charts.
And the latest TikTok charts that drops on Thursday, so keep a lookout for that. And that's our show. Find our latest stuff on YouTube and do subscribe to our channel. See you soon.